good afternoon, good evening. Wherever you are in this wonderful world, welcome to BWTM. And we have another exclusive. All the way from Canada, we've got Jelena Majelovic. Did I get it right?
You nailed it, yeah.
Right, I'm not saying it again. I'm just going to say Jelena, right?
Yes.
Right, Jelena.
So much easier.
Okay, Jelena's all the way from Canada. Very big talking point at the moment in on BWT Network. But anyway, let's talk boxing. We have a great fighter, not just a great looking lady, but a great fighter. Jelena, tell us a little bit about you.
So I am a 8-time world champion. I'm the current WBC and WBA featherweight champion of the world. And I have, right now, what is my, I have, sorry, 48 fights. Wow, so many. And I will be having my 49th fight back in France on May 18th.
Wow, you are an 8-time world champion.
Yes.
Right, when you say that, when you say you're 8-time world champion, does that mean you lost the belt 8 times and got the belt back 8 times? Or does that mean you moved up in weight? Talk to us about it.
So I'm an 8-time world champion of 3 weight classes. Mm-mm. So I've started my career at lightweight, then moved down to super featherweight, and then now I currently sit at featherweight. So
you're a bad
I've done quite the opposite. Like, you know, as I've gotten older, I've gotten like just better with time. And so I just keep getting smaller and smaller and hitting harder and harder, whereas other people usually go the opposite.
Yeah, when people move up in weight, I'm not mentioning no names, they move up in weight and they seem to knock people out better whereas they move up in weights. Yes. But you're moving down in weight, it makes a bit more sense.
Yes. Yeah. So, I mean, we've just found, like, I probably should have spent my career at featherweight, but I definitely, when I started 15 years ago, like, ages ago, women's boxing, you just took whatever you could get. So, you had a weight class, but you were willing to move up and down weight classes to get these fights. Now, with more females being involved in the sport and more, not just more females being involved, but better quality of fighters, better all-around fighters, and people who are taking this more seriously, as women are gaining exposure, then we're able to just sit in one weight class and not have to kind of yo-yo around.
So, Jelena, tell us a bit about how you got into the sport of boxing.
Well, so my story is a little unique because I started boxing. I played basketball at the University of Alberta here in Canada, quite a high level, I guess you could say, basketball, and I blew my ACL in my knee. And so I had rehabbed my knee, I was 19 years old, I was waiting for something to do, the season was over, I wanted to stay in shape, boxing on TV with my dad. And I remember the night because they were complaining about how much money they were making. Like, one of the opponents, so to speak, was making $1 million or something like that, and they were complaining. And they were saying how it's not fair. And I go, you know, Dad, I don't know why they're saying it's not fair. Like, $1 million for one night doesn't seem that bad. Like, I'd do it. And my dad goes, he shakes his head. He's this Eastern European man with this heavy accent. He goes, honey, it's not that easy. He goes, I bet you couldn't do it. And I looked at him, and I was like, I think it was the first time in my life my dad told me I couldn't do something. So I was like, well, challenge accepted. And I went down to a boxing gym within that weekend, fell in love with the sport. So it was kind of like accident. But, you know, I feel like some people are lucky enough in life to find something they're meant to do. And I just happen to be meant to punch people in the face.
Now, I always ask my guests this question. What was it like when you first got popped on the chin or popped on the nose?
So, and I also remember this vividly, because this is funny, I just had this question on Tuesday. I remember, we were just doing drills, and the gym I went to, I was one of two girls at the gym 15 years ago. And so I was kind of, like, in her turf, and she was, you know, trying to basically peacock around me, and basically say, hey, this is my gym, like, welcome to the jungle kind of thing. And we were supposed to be just doing drills. Like, I had no mouthpiece. I had no nothing. And it was like a catch, and jab.
Yeah,
kind of
catch
thing.
And shoot. Yeah.
But you just did like a steel. I didn't know anything. It was like my first, or second day. Like, I had no clue what I was doing. And I remember being a little wide and just smoking me right square in the eyeballs, it felt like. And the nose. And so I remember being like, oh my God, I not crying, but sniffling because my
shock.
Nose was watering, my eyes were watering. I was just like, what just happened? And so all I remember though is being what a cow. I'm going to hit her back just as hard, if not harder. I'm like, I'm going to get her. That's fine. She's like, oh, are you okay? And I'm like, I'll show you, kind of thing. So, I mean, from the first time, I was like, I love this. I didn't love getting hit, but I love the fact that I'm, fired up. So, I think it was I'm suited for this sport.
Did you have a natural instinct to want to beat people up inside? Because I've spoken to a couple of female fighters, and I know some very vicious female fighters, and they say, I just love punching girls in the face. I love it. I enjoy it. There's nothing better. I'm like, really? They're like, yeah, I really enjoy it.
You're crazy. I think I enjoy the strategy of the sport. Obviously, I love knocking people out. Don't get me wrong. That is the best in the world.
I knew that was coming.
Nothing is better than when you finish. And you don't think of it while you're doing it, right? But I see in my highlights, you see when I land the punch and I just turn around and walk away. Because you know that you just, mic drop, pretty much. Like, the mic drop of boxing, right? You just turn around and you just walk. And I don't realize that when I do it in the ring. When you're in the moment, you're just you kind of look and you're like, well, I should go to the corner now. This might be over, or you're hoping, right? But I don't know if I was suited. I have an older brother. I grew up on a farm. I was very rough. I was more of a tomboy growing up. So maybe, yeah, I'm sure if you ask them, they're like, yeah, no, I'm just suited for boxing. But I don't know.
When you look,
maybe.
When you look at the eras gone past, we talk about... I think it's Layla Ali, Lucia Riker, Ann Wolf, Christy Martin, Jane Couch from the UK. What for yourself? Where would you have seen yourself then?
Well, and this is the thing. So I think what people forget, because I still am on top.
Yes.
Of this little mountain here. I think people forget that, I was the Layla Ali days. It's not like Layla Ali was before me. We were the same time.
Wow.
The WBC only started recognizing female fighters as champions, or female champions, in 2005.
Okay.
So, in 2005, I was the first ever WBC super featherweight world champion. Not that was my first title. I was the first ever female WBC super featherweight champion.
Wow.
Right? So I think because, well, and that's the thing, because I'm still so in it and so involved and I still am so up here, that people don't realize that, you name these names, Mia St. John, and you say Layla Ali, yeah, if I would gain 40 pounds, I would fight Layla Ali. That was my time.
Wow.
It is my time. You know what I mean? So
yes.
It's hard to answer that question because people are like, oh, back in that time. And I was like, well, actually, I was a world champ during the same time. So,
wow.
You know, my career, I've been a world champion for 12 years, off and on, right? I've won, I've lost. But, I've been around, so I think maybe that's where people forget.
Well, first of all, I stand corrected. The first WBC women's champion.
Super featherweight, yes.
I haven't got a hat, so I can't take my hat off to you. I'll take my invisible hat off to you.
Thank you.
Okay. I stand corrected. Dang. Well, that changes things up altogether.
That's okay. Yeah, that's, I mean, that's okay. It's something that I forgot for a while. And then actually I just had this documentary come out about me here. And it was funny to see these interviews that my families and my peers and my friends have done, that they're like, yeah, Jelena doesn't realize what she's accomplished. And that was a quote unquote from my sister. And I was like, what do you mean I don't realize? And I was like, and in one of, they're in my house in the documentary, and I didn't think of it at the time, but I laid all my belts out across the table, my dining room table, and I was like, yeah, you know, maybe you're right. I don't realize it until I lay them out like this, because really, when do you have them that you're showing people like that? And I was like, yeah, no, this has been kind of crazy cool, like, but you're still in the moment, so you can't appreciate it as much because you're still... I'm still trying to be the best. Well, I mean, I'm still trying to show that I'm the best, not be the best.
Okay. The rise of female fighters in the UK. We have UK and Ireland. Katie Taylor. Now Nicola Adams has made her pro debut. There's, I think, a couple more girls are going to be turning pro shortly.
Yeah, there's some exciting things happening in women's boxing right now. I guess my concern with that is that I hope these women that did amazing and exciting things in the Olympic level can shoulder the responsibility of doing this on the professional level, because it is a big responsibility. I mean, in even in the States, you have Clarissa Shields, you have, for some reason her name is not hitting my head right now, but she was a gold medal Olympian. At the first Olympics.
Is that the girl that is dating
she's dating
Nicola Adams.
Oh, they're dating?
Yes, she's dating Nicola Adams.
I didn't know
that myself. And I just like one day Turner went, oh, all right, okay. Enough then.
No, but so there's a lot of exciting things, you know, happening. And I hope that these girls can live up to the expectations and that we don't have the rise like we did with Christy Martin, Mia St. John, Leila Ali, and then the fall again, because we weren't ready, but it wasn't the right exposure, I don't think. Is maybe the way to put it politically.
You know, you said that, but now if I let you off the hook, pardon the phrase, if I let you off the hook, then somebody's going to say, well, she says that it wasn't kind of done in the right manner. Then what are you trying to elaborate? What are you trying to say?
Well, like, for example, the UFC, what they did with Ronda Rousey and what they did with Gina Carano and all those girls, developing them to grow the UFC and accepting fighting as a mainstream sport, right? So the UFC really paved the way for us. I mean, even though we were there before, we had Christy Martin on the cover of Sports Illustrated. You know, we had Leila Ali, the biggest name in boxing. Yes, because of her dad as well, but because she was a great athlete. So we had all the tools. We just didn't have the right support or the right maybe matchups or the right continued development maybe. And so maybe that was the issue. You know, we had someone who was beautiful like Mia St. John, but you know, not able to get those great fights and those better boxing skills out there.
Well, basically, a good-looking girl that kind of fell short in the actual fighting department. Where you've got some like, that's not being disrespectful.
That being said, Mia St. John had tons of fight and fought everybody.
Yeah, of course.
Way back, but Mia never turned down a opportunity to take a fight. Were they the best fights? Not really. They kind of the styles never really matched up, and they weren't good. They weren't good viewing fights. That being said, maybe they were good fights because stylistically, you know this, styles make fights, and that's what makes things exciting. I prefer, I shouldn't say I am, I prefer a more exciting style fight because I get excited when the fans get excited. My trainer hates it because I can box, I am long, everything says I should be a boxer, but I hate the style, so I refuse to do it. That being said, like, maybe the styles that they chose to show on national TV then weren't quite the styles we needed to develop the sport. Ronda Rousey was successful because she went to finish fights, and that's what people wanted to see. So they kind of protected her, and they had a goal mark with her because she was not bad looking. She, when she was given a script, she was okay to talk to when she was given what she could say. And she went to finish fights. So there you go, ball that up, and you have a marketing, you have something you can market, you have something you can sell. So, whereas boxing maybe hasn't gotten that, or they haven't been exposed to the right females. I think now they're starting to do it. You know, you have Heather Hardy out of the U.S., nice. You have Amanda Serrano, now has some big people behind her. You do have Katie Taylor, who is, I wouldn't even say making waves. She's creating tsunamis over there. You know, and you have those, the Clarissa Shields. So you have the momentum. Let's just hope that now when they get under these lights and they get these exposures, they get that global exposure that they don't choke, I guess. You know, let's hope the lights don't blind them. Let's hope that they keep this momentum going. And I want to see amazing things from them. People are always like, there's one guy who keeps posting on my wall. He's like, Katie Taylor's coming for you. And I'm like, let her come. I think she's phenomenal. And I think it's great. And I think the things she's doing for the sport is amazing. But she's not quite there yet. She's getting there, absolutely. But, hey, we're not even in the same divisions anymore. Like, I love what she's doing. I am a fan of Katie Taylor. And I hope that she exceeds all expectations.
Let me ask you this question. Let's cut through all this. If the fight is, would you stick around to fight Katie Taylor, Nicola Adams? Nicola Adams might be a bit too small for you. Might be too small for
it's
you.
It's awesome.
Yeah, but Katie
oh,
Taylor.
Oh my girl, no.
Katie Taylor, it definitely would be.
Katie is bigger than me. I would like to see what weight she settles in at the pros. Right now, she's at what one. The amateur was what 132 pounds.
Mm-hmm.
Don't ask me kilos, I have no clue. I'd like to see where she settles in. Is she gonna stay at lightweight? Is she gonna go down to super featherweight? I mean, right now I'm a featherweight right now. I would like to go down one weight class and be a four division champion.
Wow.
That's my goals. You know, that being said, I'm 34 years old, like, with 48 professional bouts. So, you know.
Could you make lightweight? Here, I'm negotiating. Could you make lightweight?
I could make lightweight. But, you know, that being said, like, I have nothing to prove at lightweight. I've already been there. I've already done that. I got the belts, got the T-shirt. I've moved on.
Would it not be, be a super fight? Would you not see that as a super fight? Would you say, well, it's just another fight for another day?
It's just another fight for me, but it's not where I'm at right now. I'm a world champion. I'm ranked, according to BoxRec, 4 or 5 pound for pound in the world. Why am I chasing after these girls who should be chasing after me?
Mm.
That doesn't make sense. Mm. That's not what champions do, I don't think.
You're the CEO of yourself, aren't you? Tell me.
Well, Milan Lubavac is my manager, trainer. He makes all the decisions, but he's been my trainer for 15 years. He's run my career. But that being said, he's like my dad. So we have these discussions and everything goes by us. I ultimately don't get to choose. Otherwise I would have had like 100 fights by now. Like I would fight every month. That's why you don't get to talk to the boxers about making fights. I'd be like, yeah, let's bring it. I could be a lightweight. I'm a lightweight right now. Let's go, Katie. You know? I'm just kidding. I'm totally kidding. I am. But you know what I mean? Like, I think after Christmas, I hadn't trained in forever. I'd be like, yeah, I'm lightweight. Let's go. No. I love what Katie's doing. I love what her people are doing with her. I love that they're keeping her active. I love that she fought on Jorge Linares' undercard. Good friend of mine. I was sad I couldn't find a way to find it in Canada, which sucked. But I saw the highlights after, and I love what she's doing, and I love the momentum it's building for women's boxing. It's something that I started with a handful of other women 12 years ago. You know, yeah. I remember very well the night, it was Night of Champions. It was 2005, WBC Night of Champions in Cancun. And they had invited 50 past and present world champions. And there were three female fighters there. And I remember vividly because we just had the WBC first annual convention for females 2 years ago. And I was asked to give the address, the welcome on behalf of the female current female fighters in English. And I stood up there and they kind of sprung this on me last minute as the WBC does with me all the time. But I guess when you've been around for 12 years, you're family and you're not, you don't get privy to the previous information. I looked at the crowd and I was like, wow, I was looking at photos prior to coming to this. And I remember this event and there was three female fighters. Jackie Nava wasn't even a world champion at the time. She was a youth, like fighting in the youth titles. You had
2005.
I can't remember any, another Mexican fighter, phenomenal, that actually is with the WBC right now, and my brain is like fried from the day.
Was
but
she around then?
No, and that was the thing. Nobody was around. There was me, Sharon Anjos, Leila Ali, Jackie Nava fought Kelsey Jeffries at the show. They were one of the featured fights. Good friend of mine. Like, so there was only a handful of us. And I remember looking at the crowd when I was giving this address at the first ever female WBC convention. And I was like, it's crazy. 10 years ago, none of you were here. And now we have a room and a convention for us. Like, it is an incredible feat. And it's incredible to see Jose Suleiman's dream come true with this event. And it was so, like, I almost got up there and I got teary-eyed because I was like, this is insane. I remember talking to Mr. Suleiman about it way back then, and then talking to Maurizio about it and the dreams and how this momentum was building. And to be standing there giving this address and in front of these girls who just had no clue how far we had come, and being a current champion on top of it all was still kind of all like full circle coming, and it was incredible, like,
wow,
to just have that experience. Like,
it must be.
I actually, this is funny. If you give me 1 second, I think I even have a picture here in my office.
Go ahead.
Of
please
that,
show me. Please show
not
me.
Of the first convention, but hold on, maybe. Here we go. Yeah, this is the Playa del Carmen 2014, the convention.
Wow.
And that was the first ever, I want to find the picture. This is it, of all the female, like, champions and everything that went, and it was amazing. And so
this picture. Wow, that's a lot of females
there. Yeah, and this picture was, now I go back to 2005, I have the one on my wall, I have it like blown up with all the 50 past and present amazing world champions, and I almost wish that they would send me, I'll have to get that when I retire, get them to send me this one and I can put them side by side, but it was incredible. It was such a surreal moment for me because I had been there from the day one to like the day one of this convention, so it was pretty cool. So, you know, when I see women like Katie Taylor and Clarissa Shields and these people who did these same things with women's boxing at the amateur level in the Olympics, I can, all I say to them is, you know what, keep your head down, keep working, and amazing things will come because you are a pioneer of our sport. Regardless of whether you're one of the first ones in pro boxing, you're the first ones in the amateurs that did make that segue for us. Do I think I did it? No, but I think I was part of the group of it. You know, Barbara Buttrick and all those women way back then. Those are the ones who started it for us. We're just the ones who are taking that torch and keep carrying it along.
Okay. While you're here, there is a female that we have regularly on our show. Her name is Chantel Cameron. She was a GB fighter. Did great things as a GB fighter. Now potentially may turn pro. What would be your advice to a young lady who's had lots of amateur experience going to turn pro? What would be your advice to her moving into the pro game?
My advice would be to make sure, A, you surround yourself with people you trust. You know, the pro game, boxing is a dirty political game, and everybody's out there trying to succeed and step on people, I think. So my first advice would be to make sure that you trust people, and if you don't, to make sure that you're involved with the fight process and the contract process and things like that. Because at the end of the day, it is a business, and you have to look at it like that. My second piece of advice would just be to really just keep working hard, you know, like that, not let your head get too big in the pros. You know, amateurs, I feel like when you're in the amateurs, you're like, you're fighting all the time, you're training all the time, you fight multiple fights per weekend sometimes, per tournament. And then when you turn pro, at least you see it more with the men, not as much with the women, but their heads just go from like being like this to like, I'm so cool, I'm the next Floyd Mayweather, I need a robe and this and that. How about just focus on the fighting and make sure that you actually want to do it in the pro game? Because it is a jump. Yes, they're taking headgear off. Yes, they're doing this. Yes, they're doing that. But when you get under those lights in the pro level, it's different. And that's one thing I think the amateurs have a hard time adjusting to with the pro ranks. And just enjoy it. Like, this is something that is so, that only a handful of select few people get to do. Not everybody can get in there and fight. So enjoy the moments, but work hard. Because I think that was something I missed earlier in my career, is I didn't enjoy the moments. I didn't take them in, like, I was kind of like, okay, next task, okay, next, and I wasn't like, oh, what do you mean we just won two world titles with one knockout? That was pretty cool, you know, like, and just experiences, like, the WBC convention that I went to, my first one ever, like, I was so in awe that I didn't get a chance to, like, really, like, take pictures, be a fan, be a, you know, like, I didn't get to really enjoy it as much. I was so young. I just didn't know what was going on. I was so excited, and I was in awe, and I was meeting my, like, heroes, like Roberto Duran, my favorite fighter. Like, I was hanging out with him, and I was like, you're the coolest ever. I watched VHS tapes because I got into boxing late, and I was watching these tapes. I want to be you. I still want to be you. And he's like, he's laughing, and he's like, oh, you're so nice, and you're so pretty, and you can fight. It's like, da da da. And I was like, this is amazing. So, things like that I didn't really enjoy as much. Looking back now, and now they're all my buddies, I'm like, I don't know why I was so excited.
Mm-hmm.
You guys are just normal people. But I would say my main advice is just keep working hard. Like, make sure that you love what you do, because in the pros, it's a little different. Everybody's out to get you. Everybody's out to make a dollar, and you got to watch your back. But at the same time, work hard and just enjoy it. Enjoy the moments.
What are the pitfalls within, you talked about ego. What are the other pitfalls within professional boxing that women need to be aware of? Particularly women fighters.
With the fighting, the fighting's the same. Well, I mean, I guess it's been so long. I only had 10 amateur fights, so I don't really know the transition thing. Because, I mean, I can't even remember when I was amateur. It was like, I was amateur for a year, and then I turned pro. And so, for me, this is just seems natural, the pro game. But there is a transition period, and you know, I think the way that the boxing is going for women, it's And not just women, the way the boxing in general from amateur to pro, you got to move your head. You got to be able to find that rhythm. You got to really use your jab. It's not fencing. And that's what I always have a hard time with the amateurs. They always ask me advice. And I'm like, we don't fence. Like, it's not I score, you score, I score, you score. And that's changing with women, with boxing, amateur boxing as well. But now you're going more to the pro style. They're trying to get these guys to transition into the pros, right? So your fights are judged. It's a ring. It's a must, right? A round. You must win the round. Someone has to win. Ring generalship. You have to be effective in all aspects. And that means defensively and offensively. And you have to command that ring. So that means using a strong jab, moving your head, hit and not being hit. Those are things that it's not like, oh, I'm just going to put this steel wall up and take a couple punches and give you a couple. No, it's about countering and making your punches effective.
You just said that like a scientist. A boxing scientist.
Well, I feel like I always say this to my trainer because people always ask him, and he asked me my opinion, and he's, like I said, he's like my dad. And he always asks me opinions on these guys, and I'm like, I give him my opinion just like that, because what you see with me is what you get. And I'm like, but I don't know, I'm not a coach, and, you know, like, I've just learned this game from you, so whatever your opinion is my opinion, you know, like. And he was like, yeah, okay, you have no experience in coaching. He's like, you could take over for me any day, and I was like, okay. So, that being said, all of those things is just what works for me, and maybe not for everybody. I'm not a coach. I've never coached anybody. So who knows?
Holly Holm made the transition from being a world champion in boxing and went over to the UFC and defeated Ronda Rousey. If you're offered...
I have been offered. One of my good friends does the matchmaking, and yes, another one of my very good friends is a manager of a bunch of guys that fight in the UFC. I have been offered multiple times to make the transition over to the UFC. But my views on this are that there's women's boxing is now just gaining traction, and I still have so much more to prove. I know people probably roll their eyes when I say that. My family does, at least. They're like, how much more do you have to prove? I think the opportunities are endless now with women's boxing. I think, you know, being a true pioneer of the sport and guiding it along this way and being a part of this amazing journey that boxing has been in my life, to only step back now when women are getting on these HBO shows and mainstream TV and headlining on these, I'm like being on the main show. Why would I step back now to go to the UFC, which is transitioning, in my opinion? And it would be like starting over. To be honest with you, like, I don't know how to kick people. I don't know how to, I mean, I've thrown a couple elbows by accident, but I don't know how to elbow people. Like,
by accident?
You know, that left hook sometimes comes through a little bit further than it should. However, it would be starting over. Like, I don't, you know, I've been in a fight defending myself, and I've been kicked, and I'm like, why are you kicking me? Who kicks in a fight? No, people do kick, apparently, so I wouldn't know what to do. It would be like starting over.
And you don't want that.
I've worked 15 years to get where I'm at. Why would I want to do it all over again?
Okay, that's great. While we're in the subject of UFC, you know what's coming next. What would be your advice to Conor McGregor fighting Floyd Mayweather?
Oh, my goodness. I think Conor McGregor has done amazing things for the UFC and himself and his career. But come on. Conor McGregor couldn't even beat Nate Diaz the first time. Like, and that was that was more of a boxing fight. Now, you put Nate Diaz and Floyd Mayweather in a ring together. Oh, my goodness. Like, Nate says that, I think, himself. Like, I'm not putting words in Nate's mouth, but you ask him his opinion on how he would do with Floyd Mayweather. And Conor and him on the first fight, we all know what happened there. So, just run. Don't do it. I mean, it would be like me, my naive self at 19 being like, hey, $1 million for one night, not that bad. No. I don't want to get beat up by Floyd Mayweather. Like, you know, it's just, for me, that whole hoopla there is all just a ploy at trying to get more money, more notoriety. And I mean, yeah, if you want to sell a fight, I don't know if I could justify spending the money to even watch that. Like, if I got a ticket, I would probably sell it, even though I love fighting more than anything. I love boxing. Like, I went to Mayweather Pacquiao. I was at the fight. Like, I was offered a lot of money for my ticket, and I wanted to be there. I don't know if I'd want to be at that one.
So, you're basically saying that McGregor is going to get beat by Mayweather?
Absolutely. I mean, it's just so different styles. I mean, it would be the same thing that I would say about Floyd if they went into an MMA match. Floyd has no idea. Like, yeah, it's one of, I mean, yes, boxing is one of the sports of MMA, but it's like they have to be good at everything. Not great, not phenomenal, whereas we all know Floyd is phenomenal at boxing. Hit and don't be hit, that's Floyd's thing. You know, what is Conor going to, he thinks he had better footwork than Floyd? Nuh-uh. What is he going to do, rush him? Well, Maidana tried that. How did that work out for him? You know, like, everybody's tried something against Floyd. And if you don't get Floyd out in the first 3-4 rounds, if you don't win the first 6 rounds against Floyd, then there's no chance you're going to win. You might get a draw or get something close like Maidana. Maidana made it an aggressive back-and-forth fight for the first 5 rounds, right? Then Floyd got Maidana's number, and there was no even comparison near the end of the fight.
Yep.
Now, we all know what happened in the rematch. So, you get, I would say, 5 rounds against Floyd Mayweather. And if you don't make those 5 rounds count, then you might as well just sit in the stool and not come out for the 6th.
But they're saying, if Conor can land that left hand, if he can just land it.
Somebody's... I think he's been hit by hard. I think he's been hit harder. Listen, boxing and MMA are so different with the footwork, right? So these big punches that seem to land against these guys are guys who have no footwork and are standing up at the end of people's punches, falling backwards already. And then they jump on top of them and just smash their heads out. So yeah, of course, if the fall doesn't knock you out because you've hit your head hit the canvas so hard, then yes, the guy on top of you smashing elbows into your face is going to knock you out. Well, I'm sorry, in boxing, when your glove touches that canvas or your knee touches the canvas, you aren't allowed those extra punches to finish it right away. So guess what? If he somehow amazingly knocks Floyd down, Floyd has that 10 seconds to recover, get his shit together, and then figure out how he's going to kill McGregor. Not happening, not going to win. Telling you 5 rounds, if he doesn't get him out, sit on that stool, because it'll be better on your brain in the long run. Sorry. And I like Conor McGregor.
I love him too, but I just...
I think he's done phenomenal things, but listen, this is not your world. I think your world is UFC. No, you don't see Floyd. Floyd's not dumb enough to say, hey, I can fight you in the UFC. He's not stupid. Like, come on. It's 2 different sports.
You know, you
should... Holly Holm made the transition because she started as a kickboxer.
Ah.
I mean, that was her beginnings.
Yes.
So I mean, Holly Holm, I don't even think was the most exciting boxer. I don't think her footwork was great. She was an awkward southpaw who had the reach on people and came in phenomenal shape. Look at what Jane Cooch did to her, you know, like, and then the rematch, she ran and outpointed her. But it wasn't exciting. Holly Holm knocked out Ronda Rousey because she kicked her in the face. Okay? She didn't punch her in the face to knock her out. She kicked her in the face. So she made that transition because that was her knowledge. That's where she started.
Dropping some serious bombs here, you are.
These are all just my opinions.
Yeah, but they're opinions of somebody who's logical, calculated and see sense. I'm going to close on this. The world of internet trolls, internet experts, and media. Have you experienced any internet trolls yourself, Jelena? And if so, how have you dealt with them?
I just ignore it. Because you want to know what? My opinion is that everybody is going through something in their life, right? So, I don't know. Maybe someone who's internet trolling me or bad-mouthing me or telling me Katie Taylor's coming for me. Who knows what's going on in their life that they feel the need to badmouth and my accomplishments, my hard work, my dedication, and everything that I've worked so hard for. Who knows what they're going through in their life? You know, they may have had a bad day. They may be going through some stuff at home. Maybe they're having a divorce. Maybe they're going through depression. I don't know. So everybody's entitled to their own opinion. It's like assholes. Everybody has one. So, you know, it's not like it's wrong. Your opinion is your opinion and you're entitled to it. I had someone, there was an article written about me and it was like seven questions or something. And someone's like, you should ask her. The only question that should be asked of Jelena is what detergent she uses to clean her bathtub. And I was like, I wanted so bad, so badly to respond. But then I was like, you know what? This guy, who knows what happened to this guy? This guy could maybe have had a wife that cheated on him or a girlfriend or, you know, something happened to this guy that he feels the need to personally try and stab me. I don't know. Like, you know what?
Yeah,
why can't you just say, hey, I may not approve of what you do, but you know what? Good for you for what you've worked so hard for.
Yeah,
that would be my opinion. Like,
that,
you know what?
That doesn't work on Twitter. I have
no clue, but I try so hard, and I'm very passionate about everything, and I respond. I am what you see is what you get with me, but I try so very hard to not get in these social media wars, because at the end of the day, like I said, you don't know what people are going through, so I don't know. Sucks. Sometimes it sounds like reading stuff about yourself sometimes is the most hurtful and hard things you can do. So now I just
totally.
Now I try not to. I know it's so hard too. You're like, oh, I wonder what people say about me. You know, like, I have a very great support system and they keep me honest, so I don't need other people who I've never met to
keep you honest. Yeah.
The keyboard cowboys. I don't
keyboard
need those
cowboys. Abel Sanchez told me a story a few years ago, and I reminded him the other day when I interviewed him. I said to him, Abel, are you still getting posts about videos and how to coach Gennady Golovkin? He used to get videos sent to him. Wow, Gennady should move his head.
Gennady's doing something right. Like, leave Gennady alone. Like, you know what I mean? Like,
I know. His Abel's wife came in, and Abel's like, what is that? And she went, it's a video for you to teach you how to show Gennady how to box.
Right? Like, these keyboard cowboys, I'm telling you, they're just like, they're like old school Western mentality. Like, hey, I'm just going to, oh my God, shoot you. Keyboard cowboy, come on. I'd like to see you come to the gym and tell me that to my face. It's like the mean tweets. It's like the mean tweets. Like, what is it? Jimmy Fallon mean tweets. Like,
yeah, exactly.
People, like you read them and you're just like, what made you get up in the morning and write this to me? What happened to you in your life that you needed to get on your keyboard, on your phone, and write me this message?
Amazing. Absolutely amazing. It never, every time I get a message, it just goes to another level altogether. I just think, you know what? Leave them to it.
Yeah, the what comment, what detergent I used to clean my bathtub, that one I was like, okay, get out of the Stone Ages, bro. Like, no worries. Like, actually, I use vinegar and water because it's biodegradable. What do you want? I don't know.
Oh, dear me.
Jelena, I wanted to come up with something, but I was like, just leave it, Jelena, because this is going to blow up.
It is going to blow up. You will come. Your name will be next to the internet troll, and it will make worldwide news, I'm sure.
Yeah. So, I don't think I'm that interesting, but thank you.
in closing, have you ever, do you ever do any commentary work yourself?
No, and I actually have been asked recently, and I've done it actually for one MMA fight here in Edmonton, and I loved it. I think the guys, it was, I can't even remember, it was like, I can't remember who I was doing it with, but they had flown in to do the commentary, and they were like, don't worry, we'll fill in all the spaces, and I was like, oh, I got this, like, don't worry, fighting is, I may not know MMA, but fighting is what I love, like, you know what I mean? I could tell you from all sources perspectives, because I'm a fan first, like, so it was hilarious, because I got off, I only did one fight only, and, like, I was a special guest kind of doing an interview, too, and I got off, and the guy's like, this was, and this was 15 years ago, too, this was when I first started, we were talking about capoeira and, like, things like that, and he was like, wow, you actually really do know fighting, and I was like, yeah, no, I love it, and he goes, you should seriously consider doing this, and I was like, ah, I'm kind of fighting myself, and I'm a little bit focused slash distracted at the same time, so maybe one day.
I think you'd be really good. I think you'd make, you'd, there's a lot of, they're pushing a lot of women into boxing, and no disrespect to women that are in there, you know, pretty to look at, but you know for a fact they know nothing about the sport. And then you have people, the women who genuinely are from the sport of boxing, who have boxed, mm-hmm. who have performed at a high level, not getting the shots and not getting the opportunities. And someone like yourself should be on weekly, because your knowledge of the game is so, and you're so, well, you're articulate, you're funny, you know, you should be on the show.
Oh, thank
and you're
you.
Not bad on the camera, looking siblings, on the camera either. So, hey.
My siblings don't think I'm that funny, but I seem to think sometimes I...
Yeah, you'd be perfect. Okay. I think you'd be brilliant. I tell you what, would you ever come to the UK and fight? That's stirring trouble up now. That's stirring trouble up. But I've got to ask you,
right.
Would you ever fight in the UK?
Listen, my last four fights have been on the road. So out of my last five fights, four of them have been on the road. So it's not that I'm opposed to going somewhere to fight. It's the fact that now in my career, I'm finally getting paid to actually do what I love. So it's just whether the promotions can afford me to put me on the show. Like, I was offered a fight to go fight in New York, and they lowballed me. And I was like, listen, network TV, I don't even know what network you're putting me on, Spike X or something X, Extreme. I'm not interested in that. Like, I am interested in finally getting the value that I'm worth. And absolutely. So I think that's it now, having had 48 fights, being an exciting fighter with the credentials that I have, it's whether the promotions can afford me to put me on the show, because I know my value, and that's the difference that the women fighters are having now, is they don't know their value, and so they are letting these people, I guess, extort them and take advantage of them.
You go, girl. You go,
thank
girl.
You.
Absolutely.
Jelena, and let's be honest, I have the hardware. So if you want it, you gotta pay for it. You gotta come get it from me.
That's
so,
it.
Sucks for the promoters, but at the end of the day, that's what happens.
Right. Absolutely. I think you should certainly be the way that you are, and you should get what you're worth. You damn work too damn hard for it. So of course. Absolutely.
Yeah. Thank you.
Jelena, thank you so much for talking to BWTM. We really appreciate you. Do you have a final message, and how do people follow you?
People can follow me Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat at Jelena Boxing, and Jelena is spelled J-E-L-E-N-A Boxing. I don't know how, but I have a really cool documentary. These people did an amazing job, Groovefix. It's called Jelena Films. So if you want to go to jelenafilm.com, you can get the updates on that. Could be on Netflix soon. And I guess watch out for me May 18th in France. And if you're around, come. And only if you're going to cheer for me, though. Don't come if you're
going to
cheer against me. We don't need you. I have enough of those French people cheering against me. So
all those keyboard cowboys are going to come out and
right?
come and hate you now.
No keyboard cowboys. Unless keyboard you're like keyboard cowboys. Cowboy against Gale. I'm just kidding.
So do you know who
Bring
your partner
is? I love, the fans in the crowd fuel me in my fight. Good, bad, ugly. I love it. Bring it. I'll take it.
Do you know who your opponent is?
Yeah, it's a rematch with Gail Amend. So I believe when I fought her, she was 16-0. This is a rematch. I didn't fight my best. I wasn't happy with it. And they obviously seem they think they can win this time. So obviously I have reason to not be happy with my outcome. We spoke after the fight actually in the airport on the way home, right?
Of course.
Yeah, so it's a rematch of that fight. So, you know, this time I plan on actually executing my game plan. And I think if I do things properly, I should come home with a knockout. I had moments of brilliance in the fight, followed by moments of staleness. So I think traveling, fighting a little bit later than anticipated, warming up way too long, because I'm just a cowboy. I'm not a keyboard cowboy, and I do things probably not the way my trainer would love, and I'm a rogue. I'm rogue when I'm in the dressing room. I'm like, just let me do my thing. Leave me alone. So I maybe warmed up too long. You know, hopefully we do things properly and I actually, you know, get my head out of my ass and do things well this time.
I'm sure you will do. I'm sure you'll do excellently.
Oh, yes.
That was what I was meant to ask you about. The Serrano sisters. I know you talked about it before. Oh. Potentially a fight could happen. That's a fight you were looking at.
Well, that was the thing. We were offered the fight, but we weren't offered enough money for that fight. And I think Amanda is doing some amazing things and I love watching her. I watched her fight on the card that I was supposed to be on, and she did a great job, and I believe she's fighting April 22nd in the lower weight division to be a four division champion. So she's doing great things, and hopefully one day these promoters will buck up, put us on a main undercard, semi main event, and actually pay us for that fight, because I look forward to fighting Amanda Serrano.
Jelena, thank you so much for talking to BWT once again.
Thanks for having me on.
Thank you.